It's great to be part of a credit union that professes our Catholic faith.
Oceanside Christopher is a Catholic credit union, and they care about the Catholic community on Long Island.
It's a community. You come here, you feel like you know everybody in here. You feel comfortable and always get great service.
You don't get that feeling when you go somewhere else to a commercial bank or even another credit union for that matter.
You come in here, everybody knows your name. It's always a hassle-free environment, and it's just very enjoyable to do business here.
We love that we're always greeted by a smile. Everybody here is so nice. We love the hours, the local feel of it. It's just like being a part of home when we come here.
I love this place. It's because it's a natural place. I do my finances, but I also get to know my faith is being represented.
And when I use my Oceanside Christopher Visa card, a portion of my purchase goes to support Catholic parishes. Hello and welcome to Everyday Faith Live. I'm Monsignor Jim Vlaughan, joined by Sister Mary Alice Peel. In world news this past week, Cardinal Timothy Dolan, Archbishop of New York and Chair of Catholic Near East Welfare Association, Bishop William Murphy, the Bishop of our diocese, the Diocese of Rockville Center, and Monsignor Kevin Sullivan, Head of Catholic Charities of the Archdiocese of New York, traveled to Iraqi Kurdistan on a pastoral visit to that region's displaced Christian families.
The delegation visited multiple healthcare clinics, displaced camps for Iraqi Christians and Yazidis, and met many religious sisters and priests who are on the front lines of caring for the displaced, as well as bishops of different religious traditions. Joining us today is Bishop William Murphy. Good morning, Bishop.
Good morning.
It's so good to have you here.
Well, I'm very happy to be here. I had a night's rest when I got back from there.
I can
so
imagine.
So I'm ready to go.
Good.
You know, I have to say, everyone was a little concerned and a little nervous. I mean, did you feel first any fear in this trip?
Not really. And the information that we had, and we've had some very good people in the government, including Congressman King, who was helpful to us, just to make sure that anything we needed to know, we would know. There's great confidence that in the Kurdistan area, there is safety. The ISIS, or as they call it, Daesh. Mm. Daesh, D-A-E-S-H.
That's what they call.
That's the local term of the ISIS group, the terrorists. They have a pretty good control over the land that they do, that Daesh has not taken over. But it's not far away from where we were.
Wow.
About a 30-minute drive from we were to Mosul, where the Daesh controls.
Wow.
From the look of the pictures, you saw many refugee-type people. What was that experience for you?
Well, the first thing is, you're right, they are refugees in a sense, but they're officially called IDPs, internally displaced persons, because they're within their own country.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And as a result, they've been pushed out of their homes with either the threat of death or the insistence on conversion, or they have to flee. And the experience of them was very deeply moving. I cannot tell you how often the Cardinal and I would look at each other and say, doesn't this touch your heart?
Wow.
And, you know, it's just like we became an echo to each other. And why? Because almost all of them who spoke to us, I'm not saying 100%, because it's not 100% of most anything in the world. But almost all of them, the one thing they wanted to do was, I want to go home. Wow. We want to go home. There was about a 20-year-old young lady, just a sweetheart of a person. And she was talking with us and explaining life. And she said, we're so grateful for all that Catholic Near East Welfare, which is the group we came for. We can talk about that. But she said, even if we go back to our homes and the homes are destroyed, even if we have no jobs, we want to rebuild there because that's our home.
Wow, wow.
And it was just very touching from youngsters to very elderly men and women and everyone in between. It's family, it's home.
Now, did this persecution strengthen their faith, Bishop? I mean, were these people...
The faith of these people... That was it. As driving over, I kind of said to myself, what do you begin with? And I really would have to say that it was such a spiritual moment for us.
Wow.
And for them to be, what can we bring? All we can bring are our prayers and whatever resources that they can help them over this terrible interruption in their lives. But when we gathered for Mass every single day, whether it was in a refugee camp or whether it was in a church, we gathered with men and women of tremendous faith. Places were packed.
Wow. Wow.
They coming to the Eucharist with such devotion, responding in prayers in their songs. It was a spiritual experience.
Yeah. Don't you think, Bishop, that your very presence there gave them hope?
Well, that's what they said, and that's what we hoped would happen. Mm-hmm. Just to say that you're not alone. Mm-hmm. You're not alone. You're not forgotten. And that's where Catholic Theories of Welfare does such an extraordinary job.
Yeah, talk about that a little bit,
please. I wish everybody knew about it because, we have wonderful agencies that the Catholic Church has, Catholic Relief Services, for example. But Catholic Relief Services concentrates on the humanitarian, and rightly so, or emergency aid. CNEWA, as we call it, CNEWA, which is really a New York-based reality. CNEWA, with Cardinal Dolan as the chair of the board, and I'm privileged to be one of the four members of the board. CNEWA accompanies people in their whole lives. So it's not just aid for material stuff, it's spiritual as well.
Wow.
So we rebuild dispensaries, or we provide clinics with medicines, or we, as in one place, we built a prefabricated church that holds 800 in the middle of a camp of IDPs.
Wow.
And we had Mass there. It was packed.
Wow.
It was packed.
Isn't that something? And now, would you say, I mean, is it a war-torn area where you were, or it's just overpopulated?
The city of Erbil, which is where we were headquartered, we went to a couple of other places as well. Erbil is in the center of Kurdistan, only about 30 minutes drive away from Mosul, which is totally controlled by Daesh. And we had people there from Mosul, including, I sat the last night with the former and current bishops of Mosul.
Wow.
And he said, I have no more people. And we visited one woman in one of the camps who's a grandmother, but her son had been killed when the ISIS Daesh people came in, and he was given a choice of conversion or death.
Wow!
And he chose death because he would not deny Jesus mm-hmm. Christ. Mm-hmm. And she had a picture of him on the wall in their little home in this camp. I'll talk about those camps in a moment if you want. The cardinal, I chatted with her, and of course everybody wants to see the cardinal, which is wonderful. So I was able to talk with her a little bit more one-on-one. And she posed for a picture with me, holding the picture of her son.
Wow.
And there's a martyr. There's a martyr to the
show. Without a doubt. Right?
You know, Bishop, as you're speaking, I'm thinking of all the things that are going on here in this country that are speaking against these poor people.
Yeah. Yeah.
How do we change that? What?
Well, I'm not a politician. I'm a priest. And as a priest, I can say we have to change hearts mm-hmm. before we can change positions. Mm-hmm. And, we can change the names of people, but if they have the same kind of, I don't know what you want to call them, points of view that do not recognize that everyone has a right to human dignity, that's mm-hmm. a good thing here. They're living in dignity. Well, it's called, they call it in the camps, they call it from tents to caravans. And it's interesting. You know what that means? When they first arrived, these kind of open plains outside the city areas. And so outside of Erbil, I have them here. I have all these things written down, but I don't want to keep looking down at my thing. If you need something particular, I'll check it out. But so when they arrive, they have nothing. So what we first do is we set up these tents. And the tents may be large enough for maybe two families, maybe even three crowded in. But as soon as we can, we bring in these prefabricated, they look like those big containers that they use to ship things from different places.
Oh, sure, yeah, yeah.
And each of these is a caravan for a family.
Wow.
And so you go into it, and it's not as big as the studio.
Yeah.
But it has like two rooms and a little kitchenette, and it has essentials at least they're living in dignity. Mm-hmm. It's very simple. It's probably not what they left.
Yeah.
But, you know, they have a bedroom. They have a family room. They've got a kitchenette. They, you could, the clothes are strung on the old-time clotheslines.
Yeah.
From one caravan to the next, the two families have their clothes out on there. The little kids are clean, and they're well-fed. The families live together, and you know, let me tell you a quick thing. I'm jumping, and maybe I shouldn't do it this way. I should be more. We went to a school run by the Dominican Sisters of St. Catherine of Siena. Extraordinary group of women, just extraordinary. And they left a day or 2 days worth of what they said, we'll be back in 2 days. So they brought the in little bags, and off they went. And they never came back, of course.
Wow.
And these women just have moved in. They have a school for kids that would just, first you want to cry because they're so beautiful. Then you're so happy to see how happy they are. They said to me, these kids came in here and they didn't know how to smile.
Wow.
And then we walk around and these kids, well, you see, I'm sure you'll see some of the
big photos. Are up now, yeah.
And as you know, there isn't a baby Cardinal Dolan doesn't pick up.
I saw you with one too.
Well, you know, I almost broke my back. He was bigger than I thought. I can play this and I said, oh Lord, don't let me drop it.
Now, what about like medical care for all of these people? Because that's probably all
dispensaries and clinics. We supply the medicines.
Wow.
And the medicines are there. One of the biggest things, I was talking to one of the doctors, the biggest single thing, I said, what's the biggest thing? He said, is the results of hypertension. Well, that makes sense.
Yeah.
So they come in, he said, with gastric issues, pulmonary issues. But he said, ultimately it comes down to hypertension. Mm. But did I tell you? Well, I didn't tell you. I had my eyes checked.
While you were there, really?
Yeah. Well, I walked. It's, you should see how beautiful. It's so simple. But it's so up to date that it's, you know, it's not secondary care. Someone had come in with a bad cold, and they said, no, it's bronchitis. We can't give you cough drops. This is what we have to give you. It's like that. The pharmacists were terrific. So I'm walking by, and it's this ophthalmology. So I look, and I said, and the guy says, I'm the ophthalmologist, and this is my colleague, the optician. He said, want to have your eyes checked? So I said, yeah, I do.
Wow.
So he checked my eyes, and he had, you know how you put your thing, and it goes, he does
yeah,
what?
Sure, sure. It's
very same as what I have here in Rockville Center with my ophthalmologist. And so he analyzed my eyes. He said, boy, this whoever did your cataracts did a great job.
And, great.
And at the end of it, I said, you gave the same exam with the same results as my ophthalmologist in Rockville Center. And I said, by the way, and he's Jewish. He says, by the way, I'm Muslim. And I said, isn't it good the two of you take care of Catholic?
Right, right.
You know, Bishop, people out there are asking, where can they donate to help this cause?
CNEWA, Kanewa, Catholic Near East Welfare Agency, 1011 First Avenue, good. New York, New York.
That's thank the best. And if great. You Google it, you can find a place right online where you can. They also have online donations, too. So yeah. It's a great way. If you look at this, you know, this is the kind of thing where Bishop Murphy was there. It's literally taking the needs right to the people, the resources right to the people. So important. Bishop Murphy's going to stay with us longer, so stick around. We're going to take a quick break. We'll be back with more EFL News right after this.
We go and clear the roads looking for IDs. We're encapsulated in those vehicles, and we get blast wave injuries very easily inside of those things. I'm actually diagnosed with PTSD and multiple cases of mild traumatic brain injury. But I was brought up, you know, drive on, don't let your soldiers see that anything's wrong. But I started to realize that I wasn't the same guy. Having more bad days than good days set in more and more after each deployment and each injury. When I finally realized that I needed professional help, the switch for me was my family. And my wife, Tanya, thank God, she's open and honest with me and hounded me enough times to where I did go and get treatment. And I'm so happy that I sought the treatment because I know that if I hadn't, there's no way I'd be a first sergeant right now. I know that if I hadn't said help, I would have remained helpless. I definitely think that soldiers are stronger when they realize they have a problem and they ask for help.
Welcome back to Everyday Faith Live. We're welcoming Bishop William Murphy back from a trip to Iraqi Kurdistan, where he was there with a group, including Archbishop Cardinal Dolan. And we've discussed a little bit about that. But, you know, while you were gone, Bishop, and that was part of our struggle without you here, you know, the apostolic exhortation came out. But interestingly, because I think there's a great context for this, because sometimes we think, oh, good, this was written for Long Island, you know, or this was written for New York State or, you know, the country. But that apostolic exhortation touches the hearts of those people who you were with.
Well, you're right. It was written for Long Island, and it was written for New York State. Yes. But it also was written for the whole world.
Sure.
And so you're 100% right. And I can remember, I must say, when you're on the road, it's not the easiest thing in the world to keep up to date on other things when you're just moving from one thing to another. But I was on a retreat with the auxiliary bishops and some of our priests, as you know, in Assisi. And the bishops offered the retreat to the priests of the diocese who were free to come. At any rate, that's when Amoris Laetitia became public. But I was at the North American College just before that, talking with some of the cardinals, and I said, you know, can't we get bishops get an advanced copy? And one of the cardinals said to me, I was talking to the Pope just yesterday, and he said, I agree with you, you should have it, but we didn't. Wow. So the journalists got advanced copies, but the bishops did not.
Wow.
And so I didn't get it until 48 hours after it was public.
Wow.
So in between times, the cardinal and I are sitting in the car that had the two of us. There was an advanced car, blah, blah, blah. And I'm trying to read Amoris Laetitia online, and of course, he doesn't stop talking, you know. And it's much easier to talk with Cardinal Dolan than it is to be reading it. But I did, and then the next day he'd say, did you finish it? But it is a beautiful piece of, take the whole document and do exactly what the Holy Father invites us to do. He said, don't read it through as if you're reading a newspaper.
Exactly.
You should take your time and try to digest it. And he's right. He's 100% right. Now, I had to kind of do a little combination because of the time situation and the situation. However, the first three chapters are an absolutely wonderful exposition of what family is in God's plan and in church teaching. Mm-hmm. And I read one person suggesting that you begin with chapter 4 in one of these. It just shows he doesn't understand theology. But we cannot be Catholics without knowing who we are and what we believe. And who better than the Holy Father himself to give us, and he does give us, such a beautiful presentation of family and of family life. And one of the things, you know how often he tells us to go out into the peripheries, and that echoes what St. John Paul II said about duke and altum, go into the deep. So they're both alike. They are here to encourage us to bring who we are. And it's not just saying, oh, I'm going to go out and hang around with somebody at the marketplace. It's to go out into the world about us and to show them the beauty of the gospel and to show them the beauty of Catholic teaching on marriage and family life, not just by words, but by the way we live it ourselves. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So what he really does is give an extraordinary boost for baptized men and women who are married in the Lord to live the love of their marriage, to live the fruit of that marriage in a family with children, and to not to hesitate to say to the world, this is the right way and the best way to live. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And when we start there, and when we give people something to look toward, then we can start forming consciences that can make decisions.
Yeah.
And I think he's wonderful with the way he deals with it.
You know, here's where something, he talks a great deal about the fact that we have always to be ready to accompany people, and he's right. But we don't accompany them as tabula rasa, as an empty head.
Sure.
We accompany them at giving them the example and, as you said, the formation that they need to understand why Catholic marriage and Catholic teaching about family life is the most beautiful gift that we can offer to couples who are married. So we don't just accompany them and you know, agree with the fact that, hey, things are tough. We don't just accompany them and say, I'm walking with you, so, but you don't have to worry about anything because you do your thing and I'll do my thing. That's not being an evangelizer.
Sure, mm-hmm. sure. Mm-hmm. You know, the other thing, Bishop, I thought that the Holy Father was very complimentary toward priests that are doing the pastoral work with families every day. And sometimes, you know, the Holy Father can be rightfully so challenging. You're sometimes challenging to us too, which helps us to grow and develop. But there's also times as a shepherd where, you know, you stroke the sheep.
Yeah.
And I think that's what the Holy Father did in this, you know?
You know, can I just tell you a little thing? Yes, you know, yesterday we had our regular monthly meeting of the vicars, the three bishops, Monsignor McNamara and myself. And we meet to discuss the pastoral life of the diocese as at our level of saying how we're kind of they're my antennae out to the parishes. And we were talking about this. And Bishop Brennan said a very good thing. He says, you know, the Holy Father very often tells us priests, you got to do this, you got to do that. And sometimes you can say, oh, come on. You know, I can't do everything every day. And that's true. However, Bishop Brennan said yesterday, you know, as he encourages the priest and tells him you have to do this, you have to do that. He said, I would say by and large, our priests are already doing it.
Right.
Our priests are already there. We do not have the kind of priests that sit in their butts and say nothing.
Yeah.
We have priests who are with their people. So our guys are company. Mm-hmm. They already do. Mm-hmm. Now, when the Pope encourages us, that gives us a little bit more spine to give a little bit more and to make it a little bit more. But I just want to say to all of you, we have such good priests. We really do, and I'm so proud of them. I just say, let the Holy Father's words be words of encouragement to the priests mm-hmm. to do it and do it even more.
I agree, yeah.
Archbishop Kurtz from the USCCB had released a statement on Pope Francis' document, Joy of Love, saying it was a love letter to married couples and families. Catholic News Service spoke with a few cardinals on their thoughts on the papal document.
In considering the Church's pastoral care of its members who need special help, Pope Francis asked the question that surfaced repeatedly at the Synod of Bishops since the 1980s. It became a key question at both recent synods on the family, but also in the Pope's regular teaching.
Come prenderci cura di coloro che, in seguito all'irreversibile fallimento del loro legame matrimoniale, hanno intrapreso una nuova unione.
The fruit of the Church's consideration of this question was included in Pope Francis's apostolic exhortation, Amoris Laetitiae. Cardinal Lorenzo Baldessari and Cardinal Christoph Schönborn spoke about the document at the Vatican News Conference, April 8th.
Per accompagnare e integrare le persone che vivono in situazioni cosiddette irregolari, è necessario che i pastori le guardino in faccia una per una.
There are all kinds of elements in this discussion. The truth, the teaching, then the personal situation, then you come to culpability, and isn't the judgment of conscience on your state of soul a question of culpability? And you can only make that in light of your understanding of what the teaching is, and then the condition that you're in, and then you make a judgment, mindful that that judgment has to be fully compatible with where the Church's teaching is. But now you're talking not about dissolving a marriage, not about an annulment, you're talking about before God, how culpable am I in my present situation? And that's not a judgment the priest makes for you. That's not some permission you get from the priest. But vis-a-vis God, and as St. Paul says, if you present yourself for communion, it's on your conscience that any judgment will fall. You cannot make a conscientious judgment without reference to the objective truth of the Church. Otherwise, your conscience is basically your feeling, your sensitivity, your subjective arrival at a conclusion. Conscience, forming of conscience, and making a judgment about your culpability before the law, before the commandments, before the teaching, is very different. It's making a personal appraisal in prayer, under the guidance of the Holy Spirit, aware, fully aware, of what the obligations of, I would say, the moral law, and then also canon law, call you to. Sometimes it's necessary to highlight in our culture today, there is such a thing as an objective moral order. And today we also have to highlight the church is saying, even in face of that and with your struggle with that, you're still part of the family.
Non si dovesse aspettare dal sinodo o da questa esortazione una nuova normativa generale di tipo canonica applicabile a tutti i casi. Molti si aspettavano in effetti una tale norma. Resteranno delusi.
That ruins our discussion a little bit, doesn't it?
Yeah, right? And I'd like to underscore the fact of how well Cardinal Worrell expressed the teaching of the church. There is objective truth.
Sure.
You know, it's not my truth and your truth, as some people want to say. No, there is objective truth. Jesus Christ is truly risen. That's not my opinion. That's a fact.
Sure.
That's
sure.
a reality. So when you say to yourself, what am I supposed to do in this situation? If you're a Catholic Christian, you say, what does the church teach me? What does the church offer to me? What help do they give to me?
Yeah.
And if you ignore that, or you want to make up your own rules, it's not, you're going to end up making mistakes.
Absolutely. And of course, we have to help people to know what the church
exactly.
teaches.
Exactly. And that's where the Pope again comes back to saying, very often what the Pope is saying is the way you approach has to be, we have to be careful that we don't inadvertently turn people off.
Of
Sometimes
course.
We do, because, sure. you know, hey, we are all human beings. So we're not all perfect, but we as preachers, as teachers of the gospel, we have to make sure that we do it in such a way that they realize this is the best message they're ever going to hear in their lives.
Exactly, yeah. Now, the Holy Father, you know, I was thinking of you in regard to this, is going to Lesbos this weekend.
Yes, yeah.
I mean, it's kind of a similar mission, right? I mean, it's similar in a lot of ways.
You know what he's doing, I think? He is giving, particularly to Europe, which is so torn, as our population is torn, about their attitude toward refugees.
Yes.
And these are real refugees. They're not internally displaced persons. They got nowhere to go. They're out of their countries. They don't know where to go. And they're just trying desperately to hold on to life. He is teaching them that the political discussion has to take on a very different context, a very different color, and a very different attitude.
Right. Well, Bishop, it's unbelievable this time has gone so fast. I want to thank you for coming, though. And, you know, we'll do more about this on your show, Catholic Perspectives, which people are, you know, very interested in. So we'll talk more about this and show more pictures and stuff like that, too.
Great.
So,
sounds
we'll
great.
Some time.
To find out more about these stories and other breaking news, you can follow us on Twitter or send us your tweets at Telecare TV. You can also like us on Facebook at facebook.com/telecaretv. And of course, you can visit our own website at telecaretv.org.
Well, again, thanks for being with us, everybody. I thank Bishop Murphy, too, for being here. For Sister Mary Alice Peel, I'm Monsignor Jim Vlaun. We'll see you here at the same time next week. From all of us at Telecare, keep the everyday faith live. Have a great week, and God bless you. It's great to be part of a credit union that professes our Catholic faith.
I trust Ocean Cipher because not only do they have, you know, the best interest for me as a member in mind, but just they're always people helping people.
I saw firsthand during Sandy how we took care of our members.
I was one of the flood victims, and at that time when it happened, I gave up hope.
We're very grateful that we have our faith in the church, and we also have our faith in the credit union.